Barrett Kohler Publishers presents Inside Your Customer's Imagination, 5 Secrets for Creating Breakthrough Products, Services, and Solutions. Written by Chip R. Bell. Narrated by Sean Pratt. The following dedication appears in the book. To Nancy. Dominic Skinner sat in a coffee shop in Surrey, England, with his sketchpad and hot tea. He overheard a customer at a nearby table commenting to a friend on how great it would be if their hot teacups could warm their cookies. From inside the customer's imagination, Dominic fashioned the breakthrough cup pictured on the book cover and sold the idea to Mocha UK. This book is dedicated to all who partner with the ingenuity of their customers to create breakthrough products, services, and solutions. Beginning the adventure. The Iraq Museum in Baghdad contains a stone that displays a carved 9th century BC relief of Assyrian king Salmaneser III shaking hands with Babylonian king Marduk-Zakir-Shumi. Salmaneser ruled Assyria, now Iraq and Turkey, for over 35 years. 2 features of the relief are worth noting. It is the first picture discovered of 2 people shaking hands, and each man is carrying a shepherd's staff, believed to be a mark of royal authority on peaceful occasions. The handshake has been the symbol for partnership for almost 3,000 years. Some historians believe it became a trusted gesture of alliances because the open hands revealed no weapons. The up-and-down motion was intended to shake out any weapons hidden in a sleeve. It is associated with a pledge, a promise. A partnership is the paramount confederation for creating and nurturing innovation. If you examine the cultural components of organizations famous for innovation, you will see that they are filled with partnership virtues: curiosity, purpose, growth, and trust. Most innovative enterprises have successfully exercised fear from their workplaces. Most have elevated passion and erased protectionism. Most revere organizational forms that support freedom and creativity over control, rigidity, and judgment. Organizations today ardently pursue innovation because simply continuously improving their offerings is not sufficient to remain competitive. However, most organizations that are thriving today have already been reorganized, leaned, and Six Sigma'd to the max. Additionally, successful disruptors are strongly influencing their go-to-market strategy. The dilemma facing most enterprises is illustrated by the following story. The CEO of a small company was meeting with her direct reports at their weekly gathering. "How can we increase our company's performance by 10%? She asked the group. The energized audience began brainstorming ways to cut costs, boost sales, reduce waste, and tighten expenses. In the middle of their spirited ideation, she stopped them. "Let me ask a different question. How can we increase it by 100%? The room was silent for a minute. Finally, the COO said, "You can't get there from here. We would have to completely reinvent how we perform." Such is the reality of today's business world. But there is more to the 9th century relief than a handshake between kings. There is the symbol of a shepherd's crook, a long staff used to protect and guide sheep. The shepherd has always been a symbol of courage, one who protected sheep against wild animals. Through the ages, the shepherd was symbolized calm and safety. Shepherding a partnership implies the parties take great care of one another. It also suggests taking great care of the relationship itself. The king of Assyria and the king of Babylonia announced an innovative partnership with that handshake. Enter a new player on the innovation partnership scene: the customer. This other king has been historically treated as a bit player. It can sound like, "We know our customers and what is best for them," or, "You don't understand how we do business here," or, "Customers in the boardroom? Are you joking? What about insider information and airing our dirty laundry?" Some organizations claim a partnership with customers, but when the relationship is put under a microscope, the other king is merely a member of the court. While the customer is the focal point of this book, the definition of customer is broad. I define it as the person or people who is the target of your offering. That means it could be a vendor at the loading dock, it could be an external supplier or expert advisor, and it could be an employee to whom you provide leadership, coaching, and support. We all have people we serve. This book is also about encounters with customers that rely on a relationship, not just an encounter with a chatbot, robot, or programmed message. It provides the practices and perspectives to help a person, a unit, or an organization serve in ways that deepen relationships, encourage their longevity, and maximize their creative potential. When organizations attempt to create a product or service they hope the customer will buy, or they craft a solution they hope the customer will accept, the creating and crafting are typically done with a factory mentality. That means raw materials, expertise, and ideas are assembled in a protected environment far from the ultimate users and then sold to them in the marketplace. Although market data is gathered so that we can make what customers will want, the customer is never invited into the factory to assist. That mentality can fuel a separateness and an air of superiority. Sure, there are test markets, pilots, and prototypes, but the customer is never the other king, and the shepherd's staff is not a tool to protect the relationship. The purpose of business is to create and keep a customer, wrote Peter Drucker, the father of modern management. Organizations create a customer by convincing a prospect that the enterprise is uniquely qualified to meet her or his needs and expectations through their offerings. Assuming that offering continues to do its job for the customer, that customer is kept through ongoing positive experiences with the organization. This truism is based on two assumptions. The customer knows his or her needs, and the organization has offerings in sync with them. It is, therefore, an equation grounded in a certain degree of certainty. But what if the customer's needs are emerging or vague, or even unknown? What if they start out definite but become imprecise? What if their needs do not closely match the organization's offerings? Historically, this vagueness on either side of the equation would trigger a few scenarios. The customer would settle for an offering thought to be not wholly satisfactory, but would say, "It was the best I could find." The customer would not settle for an offering that was slightly off and would continue the search. The organization would try to get the customer to buy something it already had to offer that would only partially meet the customer's needs. Or the organization would suggest the customer continue the search. But what would happen if the customer were so loyal to the organization, he or she was willing to hang in there at the juncture between need and offering until it all became clearer? What would be the outcome if the organization were so loyal to the customer it was willing to help the customer discover the solution, including one it did not offer? What if customer and organization could meet at that need-offering juncture and together figure out an outcome that was entirely new? Envision what the path would be if the best answer lay inside the imagination of the customer. The audiobook you're listening to is about creating a partnership between kings with staffs. Its complexion is one that helps the parties involved source and share the very best of their imaginations. A partnership is a marriage of equals with common goals and mutual values, but different talents and resources. That marriage works when both are treated as kings, and the shepherding role is assumed by all. In the process, the loyalty of each deepens as their collective achievement increases. Chip Bell, Lake Oconee, Georgia, June 2020. Introduction. Welcome to your customer's imagination. Imagination is a place where all the important answers lie. Joe Minow. We are not actually there yet, but it is nearby. Your customer will have to invite you in. That will likely happen later on. At this point, I am merely preparing you for the journey ahead and letting you know what you might expect. There will be special provisions involved, but we can talk about those later. First, we will explore why we are here. A thorough understanding of the rationale is important, so this will not be a drive-by explanation. Let's start with a map of your journey ahead. Organizations need breakthrough products, services, and solutions to compete effectively. They need the customer's imagination to ensure the discovery of innovative and valued offerings. Accessing the customer's imagination requires a co-creation partnership that invites and attracts creative contributions. A co-creation partnership takes 1. Curiosity that uncovers insight. 2. Grounding that promotes clear focus. 3. Discovery that fosters risk-taking. 4. Trust that safeguards partnership purity. And 5. Passion that inspires energized generosity. This journey leads to ingenious outcomes and a customer who emerges as an advocate. Now, let's slow down and unpack the parts of this map with a bit more detail. Innovation is all about new. In fact, the word itself comes from its root nova. The word also has come to mean unique, novel, and ingenious. Innovation today is a big deal to all organizations. They ardently pursue innovation because simply improving their offerings, products, services, or solutions, is not enough to remain competitive. Their boards, owners, and stakeholders continually encourage them to stay on the cutting edge. Customers also want new, not just the same old, same old. Organizations typically turn to their research and development departments for assistance with innovation. They visit other companies to learn best practices they can emulate. They offer incentives to employees to provide suggestions and ideas. They create innovation centers and design test labs. All this innovating is aimed at creating offerings that will, hopefully, meet their prospects' or customers' needs and be valued. Innovating offerings that will meet customers' needs assumes these needs are known. But in the fast-paced, ever-changing world of commerce, customers don't always know what they want. They might have a hunch, but not a concrete or complete definition. No one asked for a fax machine, a laptop computer, an answering machine, or even a bicycle, but customers valued the benefits these products provided. Henry Ford reportedly said, "If I had given customers what they wanted, I would have given them faster horses." Consider what the journey with the customer would be if you understood the customer's needs so deeply you were assured of absolutely nailing a match. What if you ran the innovating approach of most companies completely backward, starting with the customer, instead of with a hoped-for solution? How would it be if you involved customers in such a manner that their hopes and aspirations were revealed, to them and to you? This is the venue where customers are treated as true partners. A partnership can be a key to accessing the customer's imagination. Done properly, it is an alliance of trust and a liaison of equality. But most organizations manage customer partnerships in a way that the customer, if a partner at all, is more of a junior partner. The organization remains in charge and lets the customer have a limited role. It's like plowing with my dad when I was a kid. When I was 7 or 8 years old, I would sit with my dad in the tractor seat as together we plowed a field. We were partners, but when we came to the end of the row, he took over. He raised the plow, slowed the tractor, made the turn, lined the tractor up on the next row, and lowered the plow for me to resume steering. I felt like a partner, but I was clearly not an equal partner, only an active participant. It was an appropriate status since I was too short to reach the tractor pedals. The customer, on the other hand, is plenty tall. What this book is about, and not about. Customer participation is not a new concept. There are many examples of customers being encouraged to get involved. The Craddock Terry Hotel, housed in a 1905 converted shoe factory in Lynchburg, Virginia, invites guests to take the hotel's dog concierge, Penny Loafer, on a walk through the town's historical district, and to decorate your own tree during the winter holidays with shoe-themed ornaments. Vans shoes enthusiasts have been able to design their own kicks since Vans' first week of operation, when the company's founder told a customer to go to a fabric store and buy cloth in the brighter color she wanted. Two of Starbucks's most popular items, cake pops and pumpkin spice lattes, came from the imagination of their customers. So did splash sticks and free Wi-Fi, along with 150,000 other innovations via the company's My Starbucks Idea platform. Participation helps customers put skin in the game. But participation and partnership are not the same thing. The focus of this book is co-creation, on getting customers fully integrated into the creation process, not just tangentially or superficially invited to participate. Dell Computers had co-creation hardwired into its DNA from the start. Michael Dell, from his dorm room at the University of Texas, started selling computer upgrade kits. He got a license as a vendor, giving him access to discounted parts, and sold assembled computers to customers at an economy price. The $70 billion company today continues to actively involve customers in design. Customer answers to, "What would you really want this thing to do?" and "Is there a different way to accomplish that?" type of questions get turned into offerings created by customers, not just for customers. Michael Dell himself visits chat rooms, not as the CEO, but as an anonymous, caring partner. What they learn enables quick turnaround when mistakes occur. Here's another way to consider the difference. When businesses are asked why they do what they do, they acknowledge they are in the business of creating products, providing services, and crafting solutions for customers. If that purpose is done well, they keep score by generating a profit and/or growing. The operative word is for. This book is about creating that same outcome, only it is performed with customers, not just on their behalf. The word customerization was introduced by management guru Tom Peters in his 1992 book, Liberation Management. "Customer focus," he wrote, "still clutches the tired imagery of us designing to attend to them. Us is active, they is passive. It's a Copernicus-like view, with the customer revolving around the products, services, or solutions provider." His metaphor suggested a better approach: to think of the relationship as being like the one between a potter and potter's wheel, where the provider supplies the clay and the machinery and the customer creates the pot, something neither one could have accomplished alone. But let us be clear on who is the customer. Labels are always imprecise. Earlier, the word customer was used to mean someone with a need and an expectation. He or she might go by a multitude of monikers, including client, patient, guest, colleague, student, citizen, patron, member, consumer, or partner. We'll call them all customers. Those with a need, seeking some individual or entity to help meet that need. When a company creates a product to be sold to a customer, they might be labeled a manufacturer, builder, supplier, or producer at the wholesale level, a merchant, seller, or dealer at the retail end of the marketplace supply chain. When a company delivers a service to a customer, they might be called a service provider. And if their stock in trade is expertise or advice, like a doctor or lawyer, they might be known as a professional services provider. Since all are providing a tangible or intangible supply of something of value to a customer, we will refer to them all as a provider. It's not a term of exactness, only one of convenience. This book is focused on interpersonal encounters between customers and human providers. The settings for meeting customer needs can be anywhere and anytime. These might be face-to-face, ear-to-ear, or even click-to-click, but they are not AI or robot to customer, at least not in the foreseeable future. Finally, an important assumption. Imagination might be unlimited, but business practices are not. This book does not suggest abandoning fiscal responsibility, reasonable capacity, or organizational values. It is important for partners in all relationships to be generous, but not sacrificial. Inside your customer's imagination, a sneak peek. Deep inside every customer is a treasure trove of half-baked ideas, creative capacity, and ingenuity in the raw. Some customers are aware that trove exists. Others have no clue. The key to unlocking this vessel of innovative goodies resides only with the customer. Think of the challenge as a bit like helping a very cautious person demonstrate courage. When an organization builds that kind of deep, valued partnership with customers, a coalition laced with curiosity, grounding, discovery, trust, and passion, three important outcomes occur. First, some customers discover their treasure chest. Second, some customers become willing to open that chest and share it with the provider. But a third thing happens that is purely magical. It changes the provider as well, and the entire relationship is enriched. The value of the co-created offering becomes more valuable to all involved, ensuring the long-term future of the partnership. There are partnerships with customers, and then there are co-creation partnerships. Co-creation partnerships operate with intimate customer connections, a high level of structural freedom, and an obsession with being the customer. Inclusion and transparency are second nature. Co-creation partnerships are those in which all parties relinquish any effort to control or manipulate the outcome. They are populated by people putting all effort into being entirely authentic and real. They are devoted to discovery and learning, not dedicated to convincing. We all wear masks, in part to protect ourselves against rejection. When a provider is completely genuine in front of a customer, it changes the nature of the relationship from cautious to unguarded. Energy typically devoted to cover and protection becomes available for insight and discovery. Co-creation partnerships value candor without rancor. Providers in these relationships are assertively candid with the intention of helping, not hurting, the customer. There is a cleanness in such relationships in which the value of straightforward interaction is unmistakable. Great providers care enough to be forthright. They are also curious and learning-oriented enough to invite and accept frankness from their customers. Partnering is always a two-way relationship. Co-creation partnerships are connections filled with zeal and obvious attention to the customer's need, issue, problem, or concern. It is the be-all-there feature of undivided and uninterrupted focus on what matters most to the customer. When customers sense a provider is passionate about championing their cause and finding a novel solution, they are more willing to open up their imagination and meld it with the provider's imagination for an ingenious, synergistic outcome that is often labeled a breakthrough. 5 Secrets for Co-Creation Partnerships. DHL is the FedEx and UPS of Europe. With over 500,000 employees, they are the largest private carrier in the world. Their commitment to co-creation partnerships takes many forms, including their annual DHL Innovation Days. Customers and business partners connect in an inspirational atmosphere to think outside the box and honor creative minds with the DHL Innovation Awards. When customers wanted help rethinking supply chains and logistics to improve future business performance, DHL created a series of intensive hands-on workshops that brought together DHL experts with customers to do scenario planning for future applications. It yielded breakthroughs like Parcelcopter, a drone delivery project, smart glasses, an augmented reality that improved warehouse picking efficiency by 25%, and maintenance on demand, co-created with DHL customer Volvo Trucks, which uses sensors to automatically send back vehicle performance data to identify when and where truck maintenance will be needed. In this audiobook, we will delve deeply into the five tactics, I call them secrets, for creating and sustaining a co-creation partnership. Their foundation comes from the components of all renowned innovation companies, cultures, and relationships. The goal is to encourage customers to discover and disclose their imagination and meld it with the provider's imagination in order to create an offering that exactly matches the customer's hopes and aspirations. Along the way, we will explore techniques for applying these secrets in real-world situations. When you watch a video of an Olympic athlete performing in slow motion, you see the sterile mechanics. But when you see the performance live, you experience something almost supernatural. The magic of a co-creation partnership is the confluence of actions, attitudes, and associations that comes from these five building blocks or tactics. Secret number one, curiosity. Be the customer. Be the customer borrows from the be the ball advice coaches give young athletes to encourage them to focus and retain attention. The curiosity secret zeroes in on developing a deep connection with a customer that bonds, affirms, and supports, thus inviting and encouraging the customer to both source and share his or her treasure chest of imagination. Curiosity is the extractor of insight. Secret number two, grounding. Partner on purpose. The grounding secret enables high-performance collaboration centered on the juncture between the customer's needs and hopes and the provider's mission and values. It's targeted innovation. It's purposeful with helpful guardrails and collective accountability. Note the double meaning of on purpose. Grounding disciplines the co-creation partnership to maintain a clear focus. Secret number three, discovery. Spark daredevil learning. The discovery secret expedites and catalyzes the collective search for innovation by turning tryouts into bold, risk-taking learning adventures. It engenders growth on steroids, learning that is empowering and aha-producing. And it provides a welcoming portal for the customer's imagination to emerge from inside out. Discovery fosters risk-taking and experimentation. Secret number four, trust. Pursue truth, justice, and the imagination way. The trust secret centers on being an active custodian of the relationship so that it always honors candor, respects clear work agreements, and has planned for the inevitable hiccups likely to be a part of a vibrant, high-energy partnership. It harnesses creativity as it guides its transformation from rough idea to polished execution. Trust safeguards the co-creation partnership to preserve its purity and wholesomeness. And secret number five, passion. Never stop courting. The passion secret fuels the co-creation partnership with signs of admiration and actions of caring that keep the alliance fresh and spirited. As an obvious source of focused joy, abundance, and gratitude, it makes a co-creation partnership contagious, motivating others to support it and inspiring them to emulate it. Passion sparks energized generosity. Making the shift from viewing customers as junior partners to full partners requires actions that convince and consistency that proves. Customers are not accustomed to being in an equal position with providers. The whole negotiation of price, for example, illustrates the challenge of partnering in today's competitive, transaction-driven world of commerce. The traditional view of, you have a need, I fill it, must be converted to use we pronouns. Co-creation is beyond customer-centric. Countless business books today focus on the pinnacle of a provider-to-customer relationship as being one that is customer-centric. Whether B2C or B2B, all business relationships are P2P, people-to-people. Their view zeroes in on the right side of a four-point continuum that runs from customer-hostile, we all can name a few of those, to customer-aware, customer-friendly, and customer-centric. But there is another, higher plane, one underutilized in today's hunt for breakthroughs world. Customer-aware organizations are characterized by customer accommodation rather than support. Customer-friendly organizations give enough lip service to customer service that it shows up in pockets of their service delivery, but not consistently. To say a provider is customer-centric generally means it is keeping the customer at the forefront of thinking, planning, and decision-making. Co-creation partnerships are about keeping the customer present and in the driver's seat along with the provider, so the customer becomes much more than just the recipient of a provider executing with the customer in mind. As explained in this book, it features an approach more like a potluck dinner on the grounds right after church. People love it because everyone contributes to the meal. The salads at the beginning of the buffet line are just as important as the cakes at the end. Its power lies in the fact that it is co-created, not just customer-centric. A look ahead. Curiosity. What does a provider need to do to encourage a customer to enter into a relationship that makes innovation far more likely? We start with curiosity, since it establishes the rapport and lays the foundation for the trust your customer needs to reveal their imagination and join you in the creation of a novel offering that precisely meets their needs, expectations, hopes, and aspirations. Curiosity is conveyed through eccentric listening, witnessing like an anthropologist, and inquiring in a way that is unleashed, meaning bold, and unfiltered, meaning without bias. Pay close attention to the partnering crib notes at the end of each chapter. They will provide a thumbnail sketch of key takeaways to practice and master. Partnership is a verb disguised as a noun. It is a force released, unnouned, when dreams connect and service is gracefully given. From the book, Customers as Partners. Secret number one, curiosity. Be the customer. Curiosity is the very basis of education, and if you tell me that curiosity killed the cat, I say only, the cat died nobly. Arnold Edinburgh. Carl Rogers had an eccentric curiosity. He and I had lunch at a restaurant near the beach at La Jolla, California, where he lived and worked at the Center for the Studies of the Person. It was the early 1980s. Dr. Rogers was considered one of the most renowned psychologists on the planet. We were strangers as the salad was served. We were intimate friends by the time the waiter brought the check. Between courses, he was charmingly open, wonderfully authentic, and as warm-hearted as a kitten. "You are the oldest?" he asked. When I nodded in the affirmative, he said, "I was the middle child of six. I sometimes felt insignificant." What does oldest feel like? We had just started the appetizer, and I already felt I was with an old friend who needed me. His queries were random, asymmetrical, sometimes out of left field, yet always with the reciprocity of a mirror. He did not interview. We explored with the casualness and cordiality of a conversation about a book or movie we both enjoyed. His curiosity was exhilarating, valuable, and new. The conversation felt like wandering in a magical forest rather than staying up on the main road. Curiosity is fundamentally an optimistic treasure hunt, a gallant search that occurs without proof or guarantee. Curiosity is a human itch in search of a scratch. It reflects a yearning to know, not in a pious or smug way, but rather like the resolution of emotional dissonance, a familiar tune that stops before the last bar. Curiosity may have been death to the cat, but it is the birthplace of ideas, and it is a static state, like hunger, desire, or affinity, until it is activated. Curiosity, in action, feeds the yearning. We start here because curiosity is the secret map to accessing and mining your customer's imagination. Curiosity shows up in three ways: eccentric listening, anthropological witnessing, and unleashed and unfiltered inquiry. Eccentric means off-center or from a unique angle, like my conversation with Dr. Rogers. Anthropological suggests viewing with the heart of a social anthropologist who seeks to interpret, not evaluate.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.